Over the city of San Francisco, an alchemical distillation gives rise like clouds forming in the upper stratosphere, where the dynamics of a new age were seeded by the views of a free-thinking culture, fostering new concepts in music, literature, and the arts. San Francisco became the repository of new ideas that took root and now stands like a beacon of light for artists, writers, and visionaries.
Considering the present world situation, the possibility of a nuclear catastrophe is more apparent than ever before. A Pandora's box has been opened, and now it is up to all of us to close it. This is not a problem that politicians can solve. Our salvation depends on the transforming power of human hearts. Only in the center of our being will we be able to find the guidance necessary to prevent our extinction.
Controversial and always outspoken, G. Mark Mulleian's painting speak of war and human consciousness. He was instrumental in the cultural clash of combining the multimedia mainstream press and the subculture press of the gay community on an international scale. G. Mark Mulleian has captured the public's imagination for more than four decades. He has received extensive press coverage both within and outside of the United States. Today, moving into the 21st century, he is embracing the power of the internet to progress his quest for peace through his amazing website, Mulleian.com, where he is reaching millions worldwide. In 1986, he was presented with an International Art Achievement Award by the Artist Society International, one of the art world's most prestigious awards. The young Mulleian at age 16 worked among artists during the genesis of San Francisco's North Beach free-thinking culture of the 1950s. The bohemian era of the beatnik generation, the first modern anti-establishment movement which introduced new ways of perceiving through literature and poetry, which in turn helped transform social consciousness and galvanize future forms of self-expression, which would become the nucleus of Mulleian and his works. As a groundline soldier at the height of Vietnam, he was nearly court-martialed for carrying his M16 rusted rifle parts in a gunny sack to protest the war. The artist's heavy subject matter in many of his paintings and avant-garde views drew the attention of the FBI to the door of the artist's studio in 1973, and he has always been considered by his peers and the public to be ahead of his time. Leonard Roy Frank, noted international author and gallery owner, encountered Mulleian in 1969, a discovery which opened the doors to one of the most unique art exhibits in San Francisco history at the Frank Gallery. Opening January 1, 1970, featuring the works of sculptor Beni Bufano and artist G. Mark Mulleian, a show that brought national public attention to the Frank Gallery and would bring people from all walks of life, ranging from young to old, from the common folk to the very famous, blue-collar workers and intellectuals.
I first met Mark in 1969, and Mark came by one day, and he has some kind of work of art wrapped around in a cloth. And he came into the gallery and he showed me what it was. And as I recall, it was a hand on a cross. And it was just a drawing, but it was very well done. I was very impressed with that. Soon afterwards, he went off to Vietnam. And he was gone for about a year. Sure enough, he returned to the gallery and we renewed our acquaintanceship. Eventually, he brought around several other drawings and paintings. And I got more and more interested in the work and in the person because he struck me as a very sincere young man who was very dedicated to his art. And I immediately started thinking about the possibility of his showing several of his pieces in the gallery. And he was very reluctant to do that. And it was only after several visits that I was able to persuade him and give him the encouragement that he needed to get away from this notion that his art was really something that was very private and he wasn't interested in showing it to other people. But he came around eventually to that idea, and he showed his pieces in the Continental Art Gallery, which at that time featured the work of Benny Bufano, who was an iconic artist, sculptor in San Francisco, very, very popular, very, very well covered in the media. People who came into the gallery without knowing anything about Mark, often, more often than not, they came in to see Benny Bufano's work. But when they came to Mark's work, there was something special about it, about the work and the way they approached it, and the way I perceived their response to that art. Like it was something like being awestruck, like it was something very, very unusual, and they gravitated to it, it pulled them into it. And they would stand before individual pieces for 10, 15 minutes, just like you would see people standing in front of artworks in a museum. And around that time, I was able to secure the new gallery, which is called the Frank Gallery, was to feature the work of Bufano and Mark Mulleian. And they were more or less side by side. Once again, the artwork of Mark attracted all of this very, very positive attention, and some of the pieces were sold, both the drawings and the oil paintings, and I was just struck by the way people approached his work, and I felt that myself from seeing the work, that it was meaningful and purposeful, and I saw that other people were relating to it in the same way. And that went on for about 5 years. But during this period, there were quite a few well-known people who came by the gallery, and it seemed to me that they were admirers of Mark's works. Elton John, for one, came by one day during this period and purchased one of his paintings, and there were other well-known people who were similarly affected by his work and purchased some of them. I always had the feeling about Mark that he was someone very, very special. This artistry was different, not just different, but unique in some ways. It was inimitable. It was a realistic style, and I actually spoke of it and thought of it as transrealistic, as differentiated from surrealistic, transrealistic being the juxtaposition of various objects to present overall a particular theme. He was not materialistically oriented. What was important to him was to get his art out there, to get out into the world of what he was feeling within himself, what he was experiencing within himself. For me, it was true art, because what it did was it not only reflected reality as it is, but it anticipated the reality that was to be. This idea of layering one coat of paint onto another to create a depth that was extraordinary in any kind of art. I'd never seen anything quite like it, and I don't believe that this is something that can be imitated by other artists. It's his own special technique. And there was no suggesting to him subject matter. It was always something that had to come from within himself. I mean, the things that he would choose for his subjects, like a toy locomotive or a chalice, and that's why I think of him as a true artist, expressing himself with utter sincerity. What he felt was important was to express his true feelings and express his true desire to bring to consciousness in other people human possibilities. In that sense, his art was really subversive. It was a challenge to the status quo. The status quo was something he wasn't satisfied with.
To the political aspects of journalism, such as that of the late Thomas Albright, Northern California's influential art critic of the San Francisco Chronicle, published a weekend edition on Mulleian surrealism, accusing the artist of attempting to turn back the clock to literalism by paintings such as those of a bygone era of the Dutch and Italian Renaissance masters. Albright found this to be a threat to the sensibilities of the 1970s abstract expressionism, conceptualism, and experimental modernism. Mulleian responds, "Should I take Albright's comments literally or conceptually?" 2 days later, the San Francisco Examiner runs to Mulleian's defense. Art critic William Zachariasen writes, "An impressive exhibit of large-scale paintings is at the Frank Gallery by Mark Mulleian that has a worthy message and well-developed technique to translate it to the viewers. Mulleian's fine sense of perspective and anatomy of heroic figures is reminiscent of Caravaggio." This 1976 mural-sized painting, entitled The Playground, depicting the conflict between Kratos, god of strength, sent by Zeus, supreme god of justice and reason, and the dynasty of the Titans of today. A visual metaphor for the people's struggle against consuming domination and exploitation by the ruling elite, reshaping a new horizon against the voices of reason at the expense of human potential. In the 1970s, Thomas S. Szasz, one of the nation's most controversial professors of psychiatry, once mailed an old key to Mulleian, who then put the key into a painting alongside a motto on a torn piece of paper that reads, "Why not leave hidden the things that are not here, and not hide things that are?" and sent it to Thomas as a gift. In response to Mulleian's gift, Szasz writes, "I was overwhelmed by the beauty of the painting. The motto is another thing still, and very apt for a psychiatrist."
Paul Deegan is co-author of Mulleian's biography, An Analysis of the Artist's Work. As a dancer of the 1960s, Deegan studied classical mime with Jacques Lecoq at his Rue de Bach school and ballet at the Place Clichy studios in Paris, and later with Barbara Weisberger's Pennsylvania Ballet Company, performed with guest soloists Margot Fontaine and Rudolf Nureyev. Inspired by Mulleian's paintings and the artist's inerrant intellectual depth, Deegan writes, "Superlatives cannot adequately express the experience of seeing Mulleian's paintings. Truly amazing work, both technically and conceptually, and a sublime pleasure in discovering and exploring the many layers that each of his paintings reveals." Insightful, mysterious, and controversial, his style is called transrealism, where the artist observes all of the refined elements that our life here on Earth has to offer. The stirring up of conflict is a Luciferian virtue in the true sense of the word, conflict, and engenders fire, the fire of affects and emotions. And like every other fire, it has two aspects, that of combustion and that of creating light, writes Carl Jung. Dies Irae, the cornucopia of Mulleian's works, and perhaps the best known. It is also one of the most complex in terms of conception, composition, and symbolic representation, a painting of symphonic dimensions. The image depicts a highly dramatic vision, biblical in scale, of the moment before the end of all moments, the moment before the end of all human sentience, the split second before the chance of choice is gone from human grasp forever. A presence on top of the Tree of Peace, which rises and descends, flying directly into the blast, compelled by the second seminal light to receive its calling of guardianship, of transformative hope. The belief of American Indians is that the eagle is a messenger sent by the Creator. In this ethereal painting entitled Bridal Path, is one of Mulleian's most complicated achievements in its attempt of capturing the very essence of a night, soft as satin, yet in a natural, though trance-like setting, an environment of nocturnal majesty and errant affection. In viewing the original painting, viewers experience the need of adjusting their eyes as one would in an actual moonlit night environment. The artist spent 3 years studying the effects of the soft, iridescent moonlight and muted colors of night on people, plants, trees, ground, and the windmill in Golden Gate Park. so intensely nuanced are its hues of light, to shadow and shadow to light, it began to play tricks on the artist's eyes 6 months into the painting. Where the blues become greens, that suddenly becomes reds in kaleidoscope colors across the artist's vision that left him ill for 4 days. Mulleian writes, "Beneath the sound of moving blades, comfort is found in unsuspecting places. Children of the night roam the bridal path like mirages of passing faces. As a haunting summer wind taunts desires that are sanctioned by a full moon's glow." In 1986, one of Mulleian's most popular paintings, The Orphan, was awarded the ASI Award by Artists Society International. In what is one of Mulleian's most sensitively romantic pieces, there may be found universal themes of profound loss, eventual renewal, and ultimate hope, as inner emotions are mirrored by a setting which is both naturalistic, but more essentially mystical. It is a metaphor which is deeply reflective and almost painfully melancholic, yet hope can be found in the physical setting which weds death and deterioration with healing, renewal, and inevitable rebirth. And time falls like leaves blown by an autumn breeze, kindling deep inner reflections far beyond the limits of time. From a fractured world is a ghost orphan who still waits on the front steps, a place where dreams are born as the rain begins to fall. In Allegiances for Conquests, great empires succumb to the reverence in a ladle, that nations may quench their thirst with water without ever consuming its contents, reveals the end of a legacy beneath an olive leaf in a Caesar's coin. In this painting entitled After the Hour, we see the vacated streets of Jerusalem 2,000 years ago, where Christ was offered a drink of water. In this painting, moccasins, an example of sublime detail, revealed here through individual grains of sand. The artist writes, "Detail in any giving work must breathe to obtain its own soul. It must have its own surrounding, spatial environment, no matter how intense or small, much like the proton, neutron, and electrons, of their spatial environment of an atom, in order for it to exist. Dry, burning moccasins do I feel beneath my feet, with a wind of rushing sand and eyes that cannot see. Sunbeams stand tall beside me, like bright organ pipes of gold, only to play upon its music sheet of sandy sea. Dry burning moccasins do I leave behind with notes of dry winds, and sunbeams play across the desert floor till I am no more." Mulleian's thought-provoking topics are nearly impossible to ignore. His juxtaposition of elements of subject matter has never failed to cultivate interest. But there are a few of his pieces not easily explained, such as this painting entitled The Sneaker. Is there a social commentary hidden quietly in the artist's warm colors? Subtly suggested here in the soft, lighthearted touches of a life we passively secretly desire, portrayed in a pen drawing of Snoopy on the front end of a sneaker, in contrast to the harsh realities cast out of tempered steel of a railroad track, symbolic of driving forces that seem to guide our destiny. Underpainting thin layers upon layers of pigment and glazes permits light to enter the painting and cause illumination from within. This technique, understood by Mulleian from the teachings of the old world artisans, rarely perfected in the modern world, has created a level of technical excellence of color brilliance and three-dimensional qualities that exceed and question our own reality. The stunning detail of the prismatic breaking of light through the droplets of water and the beveled surfaces of cut glass, The artist gives a highly prismatic quality through his translucent hues that captures the feeling of age that seems to come alive. As texture and light beckons the viewers into a captivating level thought not to be possible with paint. In this mysterious piece entitled Lost Journey, Mulleian presents an image of impermanence in man's endeavor of reaching for something higher, a challenging aspect in itself. Is the artist's statement of man's voyages into the unknown much like what compels our small planet that voyages around our sun? Are we going around in circles into a journey without a destination? If so, why? This extraordinary painting, entitled Day After Summer, gives a new meaning to realism of such magnificent completeness. His astonishing attention to detail is unmatched in the world of art today. Here the artist poses questions relating to time, its nature, meaning, and passage, with a view toward learning of time's effects upon our inner experience of living. A skate left abandoned lies leisurely to a hypnotic summer breeze as innocence releases its grip from the distant sounds of children, as life to death foreshadowed in a fallen toy soldier, reposing within a world of trust. In an era of unquestioning belief, emblemized in a Coca-Cola bottle cap of a post-war era, fades into the seasons in fallen leaves. A ball invites a game of jacks with only a single jack. A precursor of things to come, prismatic light in the memories of a passing day that still play under shaded trees.
During the 1970s, Mulleian's work had not gone unnoticed by leading art critics and academies of San Francisco. Although Mulleian's vast subject matter is considerable and far-reaching, it is not without its controversy, which would find its way rumbling through the halls and conference rooms at San Francisco Art Academy and San Francisco State University. Their criticism was over Mulleian's wide range of subject matter, as if to say, one who paints seascapes should only paint seascapes. One who paints portraits should only paint portraits. In reaction to the Academy's criticism, Mulleian responded, I have nothing to say, except I have more to say. Today he speaks out to us of our common thread that unites us together through the voice of reason exemplified in this compelling and insightful message.
The preservation of our ecological balance of our planet depends on our astute state of consciousness in attempts to comprehend the intricate ecological assembled safeguards provided by nature and the states of heterosexuality, bisexuality, and homosexuality seems to establish the need and importance of harmony between the three states in order to keep the balance, preserving our planet and us as a species. Heterosexuality for the propagation of our species, homosexuality functioning as a safety valve preventing overpopulation of our species, bisexuality serving as a nuanced fine-tuning of the layered integration modulating from hetero to homosexuality. It is possible that if this one of nature's safety valves weren't ever in place, we as a biological species might have become extinct long ago. Understanding ourselves makes it possible for us to exist in the bigger existence.
In San Francisco's Castro District, where Mark has made his home for more than three decades, we talk with him at his favorite home, Twin Peaks, at 17th and Castro.
Yeah. Here we are at Twin Peaks Bar, and I've been coming here since the early 1970s. And it's increasingly becoming a mecca for artists, writers, and free thinkers. Dies Irae probably was one of the single paintings that took the longest time to paint. It took 2 years. And actually, the concept of Dies Irae came to me in 1968 and was not painted until the 80s. And Dies Irae is a very powerful piece. It's very indelible, and it has a far-reaching effect, and it's timeless because it speaks of a very critical point of not just our country, but of the world.
There is one special secluded place where Mulleian often takes refuge, San Francisco Sutro Park. Here he finds solitude to collect his thoughts and reflect. Many of his paintings were conceived here, paintings such as The Orphan, Dies Irae, and Atlantean Pharaoh.
From the beginning, I have always lived with the awareness that I am my own student and this world is the university through which I may learn to translate, galvanizing a higher learning, and that money may be regarded as riches, but not true wealth. True wealth is the wealth that holds us in high esteem as guardian warriors, inherently illuminating the natural endowment of our individual endeavors in the light of ignorance, offering us a choice as protectors of our environment and practitioners as intelligent beings. True wealth is the wealth of knowing that we are more than who we are in the eyes of nature.